Good morning, guys. Good morning. All right. All right. So, are y'all ready for real church? I think we need to do God is good this morning. We got to get up. We got to get. Ryan, are you going to lead God is good? Can somebody get Ryan a microphone over there? I told you you'd miss me picking on you, didn't I? All right, so I'll tell you what, this side, we'll let you guys lead, all right? One, two, three. We got, whoo, was that mine? That was mine. A little loudmouth over there.
I can tell who he's related to.
Oh, yeah, oh, yeah. His mama. All right, so do I have some kids that can come up and help us with our vision this morning?
Our vision is to reach the lost for Christ, meet the needs of our community, and impact our world. Love, truth, and grace.
Good job. All right. Good job, kids. Good job. Way to go. All right. Can you adults say that along with me, please? Our vision is to reach the lost for Christ, meet the needs of our community, and impact our world with love, truth, and grace. And whose responsibility is that? That's right. If you have not already, please fill out a connection card. We got the little white boxes by the doors right here. There's cards in there called connection cards. If you have a prayer request or a need or a concern or have a decision you want to make, anything like that, put it on there. We can get in touch with you. You guys also know that you can follow along with our daily bread. It's a daily devotional many of us participate with. And let's get the rundown on today's daily bread.
It was talking about pure worship, and it talked about when Jesus got upset about the money changers and he overturned the tables, and he wants our worship to be pure and not be about busyness or business, that it's just pure in heart worship.
Amen. And you can get a lesson like that every day at our daily bread. Did we just have technical difficulties? Is that what I seen up there? Doom, 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 doom. Take a soldier program out there in our lobby. We got a briefcase with a lot of little bitty plastic soldiers in there. Please pick one up. Take it home with you. Put it on a dresser, nightstand somewhere. God is good.
Awesome.
All right, I was just checking. You know, make sure you are awake. It's getting kind of quiet in here. All right. But yeah, take that soldier, put it on a dresser whenever you see it. Little soldier, take a few moments to say a prayer for our military personnel that are serving out there as well as our first responders. His Way Youth Service, Sundays, 10:30 a.m., Wednesdays, 6:30 p.m. Y'all please give our youth a round of applause. Wakulla 1 every third Thursday of the month at 6:30 p.m. at the Wakulla County Library. I don't know what the theme is. They have a different theme for their, you know, for the food, so, you know, so bring a dish fellowship there. But as soon as I find out, I will let you guys know. First and third Mondays of the month, we have the Sewing Circle, 9 to 11, right here at the church. Miss Treva, Miss Stephanie. I think Miss Treva didn't get the time change note this morning. She's not here. No Miss Treva this morning. Miss Stephanie, stick your hand up over there. All right, if y'all want to learn how to sew, if you have anything that needs to be altered, anything like that, see Miss Stephanie over there, and she will take care of you. Or just be here on the first and third Mondays. Third Tuesday of the month, we have the Bible with Brother Bruce right here at the church, 6:30 p.m. Please bring a side dish. Bruce informed me that we are going to have, it's actually on St. Paddy's Day. Our third Tuesday is this round. So he is going to make corned beef and cabbage. So bring a side dish that accompanies, you know, corn, you know, bring some cornbread. How about that?
You know, or boiled potatoes.
Boiled potatoes. There you go. You bring some Irish-themed foods. It'll be great. Second Saturday of the month, 7:30 a.m., men's prayer breakfast right here at the church. That is this coming up Saturday. So come on, guys. Come on down. Join us. next Saturday, and we'll have a good breakfast, and we'll make a list of things to pray about, and we will pray. We have our small group movie Saturday, April the 11th. Y'all seen the preview right here before our service. It's going to be at the Regal Movie Theaters at 1220. The name of the production is Jesus, and it is broadcast live. So you're going to be watching it on screen, but it's going to be a live broadcast of the actual production. So come on down, join Jeff. He's putting that together back there, and let's have a good time. Next Steps new membership class is today, March the 8th. So if you'd like to join our wonderful little church family here, just stay after our regular service there, and we'll take care of you, and you can, hey, we'll be glad to have you. I think they're serving lunch, right?
JJ's taking care of it. Just see JJ after service.
All right. Baptism service is going to be on April the 12th. So if you'd like to get signed up for our baptism, we got lists out there in the lobby. You can put your name down on there or just come the day of and be prepared. You can follow along on Facebook. Hi, Facebook, and all you guys that are out there watching us right now. We also stream on YouTube, and you can watch us live, or you can watch the old services that you may have missed.
Happy birthday to you.
Birthdays! We got one running to the floor.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you.
It's my son Matthew's birthday on Tuesday. He turns 14.
Right. Son Matthew turns 14 on Tuesday. Hold on, baby. Let's start from music. Hold on.
Cousin's about to have a grace turn free. Have a grace turn free.
Okay. Your cousin's next week? All right. So we got one standing in for the cousin. We got one standing in for the son. Any more birthdays this week? Ronnie, is it your birthday? No. Mikey, how are we going to sing happy birthday without you? There's another one coming in.
Waiting.
Oh, you're just waiting. Okay, I got you. All right. Are you ready to sing? All right, do we have any anniversaries out there this week? Anybody got a special date? Yeah, we do? We got volunteered, huh?
Yes. 5 months sober.
Woohoo! All right, fantastic. All right, don't say nothing, Mikey.
Mikey, you want to talk about something?
Yeah.
What do you want to talk about?
It's the kitchen.
The kitchen? Where is it?
Is it in the back?
Is it almost done?
Is it done?
Not quite yet.
Almost?
Almost.
Well, I pray real hard. That's not more.
We know the prayer is working. Mikey, I honestly believe if you hadn't been praying for a kitchen, we probably wouldn't have one right now.
We got now. I put more money in the box just now. Just today.
That would probably help, Mikey.
Yeah. I watch my show.
You watch your what?
My show.
Your show, what show?
Ernie Garcia.
Or Ernie Garcia.
You say it. You told me to tell us, y'all. This church is like this, the kitchen is like that. It's always we pray that. Paul's saying kitchen.
Amen.
He says, yes. We say yes. We work on it. We're hard. I say yes.
Very good. You want to pray about it?
Yeah.
Let's do it. Father, we just ask right now, Lord, you help us finish up this kitchen and get all the other little things done that need to be done. And Lord, that you just make a way where there seems to be no way. And thank you for your blessings. In Jesus' name, amen. Yeah. Thank you, Mikey.
Yeah.
God's good?
All the time.
All right, we're still with it. We're still here. All right, praise reports, prayer requests, what we got. I'd like to ask y'all, I have a prayer request. You know, I told y'all that my cousin David Edge had fallen ill and had pneumonia, and the night of his mother's funeral, they had to take him to the emergency room. Well, he passed away yesterday morning. So y'all please keep the Edge family, David and his entire family, in y'all's prayers.
Okay, so I have a couple. Rhonda North, which is Miss Frances' sister, she's got a heart clot in her. She's got a blood clot in her heart, and she's been at TMH. And one of my past ladies, Lacey Adams' family, keep her stepmom and her step-uncle in her family. I don't know his name, but her name is Donna. And I just want to thank God for what he's doing in our house. He's moving mightily in each of our lives, and we just want to praise him for that.
Amen.
I just hope that everyone that is sick will heal up and that they heal up with joy and love.
Amen. Did everybody understand that one? Hope that everyone is sick will heal up with joy and love.
I pray that everyone has a good life and everyone has a lot of fun. And I pray that God has a good time with everyone in his heart. Amen.
Amen.
All right, good monkey.
I want to give God all the praise that I will start my new job at Carrabba's this week. Woo-hoo. And I just want to ask everybody to keep praying for my grandma. I mean, still ain't doing too great. And I also want to thank God for the changes he's doing in my life.
Amen. What's grandma's name?
Carol Story.
Okay. Carol Story.
Amen.
Praise reports, prayer requests.
I want to praise the Lord. This morning I got a text from my father, and the passport is finished. So now they step up. I mean, they go up to trying to file for the visa. So this is the hardest one. So, you know, we speak victory over this because, you know, it's God will make a way.
Amen.
Any more praise reports, prayer requests? All right, Ed, I will hand it over to you.
All right, let's get the kids and the praise team up, huh? Father, we just come now thanking you for this day, Lord, thanking you for the opportunities you give us each and every day, Lord, to go forth and spread the good news. I pray, Lord, that you will continue to lead, guide, and direct, Lord, that you will continue to heal the sick and give to the needy. And, Lord, we do have many needs, but thankful we have you to fulfill those needs. Lord, we just ask that you bless us as you see fit, that this service today goes your way, Lord, and we continue to be faithful to your word and obedient to your will, always walking your way and each day getting closer to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Careful little hands, what you do.
Little ears.
Oh, be careful, little ears, what you hear. Oh, be careful, little ears, what you hear. For the Father up above is looking down in love. So be careful, little ears, what you hear.
Little mouth.
Oh, be careful, little mouth, what you say. Oh, be careful, little mouth, what you say. For the Father up above is looking down in love. So be careful, little mouth, what you say.
Little eyes.
Oh, be careful, little eyes, what you see. Oh, be careful, little eyes, what you see. For the Father up above is looking down in love. So be careful, little eyes, what you see.
Well, I guess I have to stall right now. Everybody greet. My husband is dealing with a dirty diaper, so yeah. Oh yeah, kids can be released. Yeah, and everybody can greet, and me and greet. Yes.
Let's all remain standing as we worship together.
Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done chaos back into order. Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of Glory, the King of Glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, just like the sun lit all of his brilliance. The King of Glory, the King above all kings.
Hallelujah!
This is amazing.
Come on, church, he's worthy.
Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
Sing it a little louder now.
Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I see. All that you've done for me. All that you've done for me.
Hallelujah.
You know, I want you just to think about the lyrics of this song, and this is a really amazing. God is an amazing grace. You know that because of Jesus died on the cross, that we get into the Father. I mean, if you read the Old Testament, it was intense. It was really intense. How God is so holy. You know, it's like just not everybody just goes straight to the Father, to God Almighty, because you know. Again, I said about, you know, I'm reading Job right now. You know, his children, in the beginning, his children party, you know, during the weekend or whatever it is. There were all these sinning stuff and everything. It took Job to sacrifice the burnt offering on behalf of the children. And Job was a righteous man.
Amen.
So I can't imagine if Jesus didn't do what he did for us.
That's right.
First of all, I have to find a righteous person or the priest or anybody, you know, that is righteous to do the burnt offering on behalf of me, because, you know, I know I failed God so many times throughout the day. And not only that, it seems like, okay, I guess I'm not good enough, or I'm not holy enough to go straight to the Father. So I thank God. Thank God for Jesus.
Amen.
Because his amazing grace that enable us to go straight to the Father. And we, you know, and we are, because of him, that, you know, that just we can go. I mean, it's just really, I mean, it's just amazing to just think about these lyrics. It's just, whew. It's
hallelujah. Amen. Y'all give the Lord an off-clap offering, please. Thank you, Jesus. You may be seated. I mean, it's really special when you get to know that, like my wife was just saying, that we can go straight to the Father because of Jesus. Speaking of going straight to the Father, we got a couple graduates today that have made some big changes in their lives. I know I'm excited to see them graduate. I know they're excited to see themselves graduate. I know their families are really proud of them. So without any further ado, we're going to have Ramsey Kelly. Come on up here, Ramsey. He worked hard for this. We want a photo of it, even though his name's spelled wrong. We'll correct it. Yeah.
I want this one, too.
Okay, you can have two. Go ahead, Ramsey, share it with us.
Ooh. I'd like to thank everybody at Promised Land. It's a lot of hard work, a lot of long hours, but I met a lot of good people, and I'm glad I made the decision to come here. Thank you, JJ, most of all, Richie, Ed, Pastor Glenn. It's been a good experience. Thank
Amen.
You, Jesus.
Amen. All right, we got one more in the house today. Let's hear it up for Joshua Taylor. Amen. Here you go, Josh. Share with us.
I'd like to thank God, first and foremost, for walking me down this path. It was really rough, but I made it. There's times when I didn't think I was going to make it. There's times when I didn't deserve to make it, but I made it. And for all you new guys in the program, it gets better. It's going to get better. Trust me. But like I said, I just want to thank God for everything he's done for me in my life.
Amen. Y'all give it up for Josh. We'll get our ushers to come forward at this time. Father, we just thank you so much for this day, Lord. We thank you for the privilege and honor of being able to come straight to you. Lord, as my wife said, we don't deserve to. We fail you so often, so many times. Thank you for loving us enough to send your son to make a way. We have access to you. We love you, Father. We praise you. We ask your blessings, Lord, on this service. In Jesus' name, amen.
You give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore. Every heart that is broken, great are you, Lord.
Come on, sing it one more time. You give life.
You give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore. We pour out our praise. It's your breath.
will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, this bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, this bones will sing.
Praise, Lord.
Will
because you are worthy of praise.
Come on, church.
Because you are worthy of our worship, God.
Tell him how great he
because
is.
Because you are great. You are good, dear God. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, Lord.
All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing.
Yes.
Great.
All the earth will shout his praise.
All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. This bones will sing. Great.
Yes, you are great. You are great, Lord God.
Are you, Lord? It's your breath in our lungs. So we
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Oh, wow. God is amazing. God is good.
All
God
the time.
Good. Yes. Yes, it's good to be alive. An hour early. Yes. And this morning, before we enter into the worship, you know, we just want to put aside anything that, you know, is going on this morning. You know, we had it already this morning because I guess it was early, so we already had it. So this morning, I was given a message from God, I think earlier this week. And the title of this message is, Give the Control Back to God. So, what happened was, the illustration that I got was, everybody know Alexandria, right? Anybody know? Everybody know Alexandria. I mean, it's my daughter, the one that did the thing, hand motion and everything. So if you know Alexandria really well, she is my right hand. She is my right hand at home with her siblings and everything. In fact, she is so much my right hand, and of course Pastor Glenn also. She, you know, there's things at the house, you know, we let her make decision on behalf of us. You know, especially like, you know, like anything with the brothers, you know, with the sister, and sometimes, you know, like birthday parties, you know, she made decision on behalf of us. So she is very trustworthy, you know, and I love her to death, you know. So she, you know, so she's very used to organizing, manage and handle things around the house. Even sometimes, you know, whenever they go to school, you know, with Christian, I always tell her, Alexandria, keep eye on Christian, you know, because, you know, so, you know, she is really my eyes and my ears and, you know, in the house and outside the house. So she has that, you know, that sense of organized and everything is around the house is like under her control. So, you know, we give that to her. So anyways, it was on one Saturday, we had a birthday party for her. And remember, she's usually the one that is organizing all the birthdays and everything for her siblings. So that day, I said, Alexandria, let me take care of it. You just enjoy your birthday. Let me take care of it. I'll find the games. I'll find the activities and everything. So anyways, that day, that Saturday, and I got the games, you know, It was really fun games and everything. And then in the middle of the game, she got up and I was like, Mommy, stop. This is how the way is supposed to go. This and that. And I was like, Alexandria, stop it. You sit down, relax, enjoy your birthday party. And she was just like, so stressed out. And it's like, just relax and sit down, enjoy it. So anyways, we played and we had a great time. And, you know, in fact, you know, it was, you know, she laughed so much and everything. So we really had a great time. And after the party was over, she came to me and she said, Mommy, thank you so much. I really had a good time. I really had a blast. And it was really nice just to sit there and enjoy the game and enjoy my birthday. And I was like, you're welcome. I told you. Trust me. I know how to do games. You know, I mean, it's like, I mean, I know that I'm old, but I'm not that old. You know, it's like, you know, I know the fun thing for the kids, you know, or for, you know, for y'all, you know, young people. So anyways, but we heard this before a lot about this. About let God have the ultimate control over our lives. While this seems amazing in theory, it can be super difficult to do. And again, back to what that day with Alexandria. Even though she let go a little bit of that control over her own birthday party game, you know, in the middle of the game, she didn't trust me enough that she thinks that the game is supposed to be one certain way. Which, well, we have another way that was actually more fun than what she had. Yes, it's funny. So, when we trust Him and give Him the control, we know that He will guide us down to the right path. He is on our side, and He is worthy of our trust. That means giving Him full control of our lives, because He knows exactly what He's doing. I'm talking about God. In Proverbs 3:5, chapter 3 and verse 5, trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not lean on your own understanding. I think we know all those, that verse. And also in the Psalm 9 and 10, and those who know your name put their trust in you, for you, O Lord, have not forsaken those who seek you.
Amen.
And there's a song from Elevation that, hang on a minute, it sounded like this. I'm gonna see a victory, I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory, I'm gonna see a victory, for the battles belong to you, Lord. Come on, sing it. I'm gonna see a victory, I'm gonna see a victory, for the battles belong to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory, I'm gonna see a victory, for the battles belong to you, Lord. Come on, sing it one more time. I'm gonna see a victory, I'm gonna see a victory, for the battles belong to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory, I'm gonna see a victory, for the battles belong to you, Lord. Woo! And this morning, release that control. The battles belong to Him.
Thank you, Jesus.
It's not us. It's not us. He has it.
Amen.
Give that control back to Him. Because as much as you think that you know how your life turned out to be, you have all your life planned, five years, 10 years. If God, in the midst of it, He will store it anyways.
Amen.
Because your plan is not His plan. His plan is not our plan. Give the control back to Him. Because
thank
the
you,
battle
Jesus.
Belongs to Him.
Yes.
It's not us. Don't stress out about it. I'm preaching to myself too because I'm stressed out about something this morning. Give Him back the control over your life.
Amen.
Just like Alexandria think that she knows how the game supposed to go, she doesn't know it. She doesn't know it. As much as you think you know exactly how your life's supposed to go, and as much as you plan your life, there is somebody this morning, they didn't wake up. Even though this morning they have the plan to do something, because God has a different plan. He's in control. Trust Him. Trust Him. Just release that control and give it back to Him, because the Bible said, trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not lean on your understanding. And this morning as we sing this song, whatever that chain is holds you back this morning, give it to God. The battle belongs to Him.
Amen.
The battle belongs to Him.
If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice tell the same old lies, if you're trying to fill the same old holes inside,
there's a better life, there's a better life.
Church,
you got pain. He's a pain taker. If you feel lost, He's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, He's a prison shaking savior. You got chains.
Woo!
He's a chain breaker.
Breaker.
We've all searched for the light of day in the dead of night,
and we've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. We've all run the things we know just ain't right.
Come on, church. There's a better life.
There's a better life.
Yes. Better life.
There's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you've been lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking. You got chains. He's a chain breaker. If you believe it, if you receive it,
come on now.
If you can feel it, somebody testify.
Jesus!
Woo! Jesus!
If you believe it. If you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify.
Jesus!
You got pain. He's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. You've got chains, he's a chain breaker.
Hallelujah! Amen, amen, amen. You may be seated. God is good. Awesome. Whew. Thank goodness he took our pain. Amen. He broke our chains. Whew. So we're starting a new series. I bet you can't guess what the title of the series is. Some of you can read the billboard. That's fine. The television. Yeah. Following Jesus. Yes, we're starting a new series called Following Jesus. Just let me ask you a quick question. If you were on track to stay in tune and follow Jesus, don't you think we'd have a lot less problems in our life? I thought I'd get a bigger amen than that. Amen?
Amen.
Yep. Now, today we're going to be talking about following Jesus to the river. Anybody know anything about the Jordan River? Maybe read a little bit about the Jordan River. You know, Jesus was baptized in the Jordan River. That was the beginning of his ministry. But the river itself was really nothing extraordinary. It really wasn't nothing marvelous about the river. It was just a common place. It was a place where they gathered water to cook with. They gathered water to do laundry with. They took their livestock down there to drink from the water. It was a water source for the entire community. It was just really a very common looking river. It wasn't really anything magnificent about it. The only thing that was magnificent about the Jordan River really was the things that took place at the Jordan River with Jesus being baptized. When Jesus stepped into the Jordan River, it changed everything. Mark 1 tells us about another man that was sent by God who lived along the Jordan River. Does anybody know who that was? John the Baptist. That's right, John the Baptist. And so let's go to Mark chapter 1. We'll read starting in verse 1. It says, the beginning of the gospel about Jesus Christ, the Son of God. That's a mouthful right there. Then what's being told right now is the beginning of the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. It is written in Isaiah, the prophet, I will send my messenger ahead of you who will prepare your way. A voice of one calling in the desert, preparing the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him. And so John came baptizing. Did anybody not know that his last name was not Baptist? Yeah. I know a lot of people think John's last name was the Baptist, right? You know, the middle name, last name Baptist. No, he was called John the Baptist because he was baptizing, right? So John came baptizing in the desert region and preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. Now, this is important that you understand this. They had baptismal or washing ceremonies already where they would do for purification for the priests and for purification of other things, but it was not for the repentance or the forgiveness of sin. So when John came and telling the people to be baptized, common folks to be baptized for the repentance and the forgiveness of sin, it was preparing the way for Jesus Christ. It says the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem went out to him, confessing their sins, and they were baptized by him in the Jordan River. So John had a huge impact as for before Christ stepped in, before Jesus came. It says, John wore clothing made of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He had to have been a sight, right? Can you imagine this guy with this long hair, camp wearing camel hair, eating locusts and wild honey, hanging down by the river's edge, by the bank, waiting on people, telling everybody, repent! Be baptized! I mean, I'm sure there was probably some folks that thought he was nuts, right? I mean, if you were to drive by the Sopchoppy River and there was a guy down there wearing camel hair, eating wild locusts and honey, saying, repent! Repent! Be baptized! You need your sins forgiven! How many of you would join in over there? Yeah. I'll be honest. This is real church, real people. I'd be like, I don't know about you, dude. Yeah, so... Yeah, but this is where John was, and he was down there, and he was doing what God had called him to do. And here's the thing, as crazy as it may seem to us to try to say, hey, you know what, there's something happening over here, when the Holy Spirit's involved, it changes everything. Because with the Holy Spirit involved and John being obedient to God and him doing what God called him to do, even though the people may have thought he was weird, and even though they might not have understood everything he was saying, they were drawn to the message because it was the message from God. And church, this is just a side note. It has nothing to do with our sermon today, but I want you to understand, no matter what God calls you to, if he's in the middle of it, people will be drawn to it so they can hear the message that God has for them. Amen? That's just a side note. And this was the message. After me. What was the message he was sharing besides repentance and forgiveness of sin? He says, after me, there will come one more powerful than I, the thongs of whose sandals I'm not worthy to stoop down and untie. Well, what a message, right? Look, there's one coming after me. Y'all down here listening to me telling you to be baptized, to repent for the forgiveness of sin, but there's one coming after me who I'm not even worthy to stoop down and untie their sandals. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. Somebody say amen. Amen. John was the messenger and the preparer for the promised Messiah. Church, we are promised from God's word that we will be baptized with the Holy Spirit through Jesus Christ. Amen. Mark 1 and 9, let's read it real quick. Mark 1 and 9. I didn't give you that one. Well, I have some other ones you probably don't have either. Mark 1 and 9. Jeff will look it up for us real quick. Yep, thank you. And at that time, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan River. John said, there's one coming. And guess who came? Jesus came. While I'm talking, Jeff, you can look up Matthew 3. Verse 13, Matthew 3, verse 13. So John said he was coming, and Jesus came to the Jordan to be baptized by John. Now, here's the thing. John already said, I'm not even worthy to untie his sandals. And yet here is the Messiah, the Son of God, God incarnate in flesh, coming to John for baptism, for the repentance of sin, but he was perfect. He didn't have sin. And so let's read the passage of scripture from Matthew chapter 3, verse 13. It says, then Jesus went from Galilee to the Jordan River to be baptized by John, verse 14. But John tried to talk him out of it. I'm the one who needs to be baptized by you. I don't know if you've ever experienced anything like this. God will call you to do something. You just know you're not worthy to do it. You just absolutely know there's nothing in you that gives any iota that you should have any ability to accomplish the task. Most of that time, that's any time we begin to testify or share who Jesus is. I mean, we know our shortcomings, right? But when God calls you to it, he wants you to do it regardless of how you feel. In fact, when we're weak, that's when we're strong, right? It says, but John tried to talk him out of it. I'm the one who needs to be baptized by you, he said. So why are you coming to me? Verse 15, but Jesus said, it should be done, for we must carry out all that God requires. So John agreed to baptize him. So Jesus told him, said, it's got to be done. This is what God requires. God requires that we do this, that this happens. We must do it. Church, again, we're trying to learn lessons as we read the passage of Scripture that God has called us to do things that sometimes, yes, we're not worthy to do, but he's called us to do it anyways because it's his plan for us. Jesus said it must be done, so we must carry out all that God requires. So John agreed to baptize him. Verse 16. And we're going to do verse 17 too. After his baptism, as Jesus came up out of the water, the heavens were opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and settling on him. Imagine this, church. Imagine you're there at this very common river. There's probably some cattle upstream or downstream. There's sheep there. There's people there with their water jars, and there's probably a hustle and a bustle of busyness that's happening there. And Jesus steps into the river to John as John is there baptizing people. And he says, I'm here to baptize you. And John says, no, I'm not worthy to baptize you. You baptize me. And he says, no, this has to be done so that all that is proper, all that's been ordained takes place. And the minute Jesus comes up out of the water, the Holy Spirit descends upon him. Says like a dove. We always think that maybe it's a picture of a dove. I always think, I don't know if anybody here ever been dove hunting. If you've been dove hunting, say amen. Okay. Well, if you go dove hunting, how do doves sound when they take off? Right? Is that all right? Is that a good impression? Do I get an A+? Okay, I got a B over here. Okay. All right. Anyways, if you remember in Acts, when the Holy Spirit descended upon them and cloven tongues of fire fell on them, what does it say? It says the sound of a mighty rushing wind came. Think about this, church. So here they are. There's this mighty rushing wind, the sound of this dove. Maybe it was a dove, maybe it wasn't a dove, but regardless of what happened, it descended upon him like a dove and it lit on him. And there was a voice from heaven that said, this is my dearly loved son who brings me great joy. Think about that. You're there at the river. You're watching all this happen. And all of a sudden, everything stops. And a voice from heaven is heard saying, this is my son, my beloved son with whom I'm well pleased. And you got to know, at that moment, everything changes. The Jordan River wasn't so common anymore. The things that took place weren't so common anymore. It's easy to understand why John was hesitant. It's also easy to understand when he said, behold, the spotless Lamb of God, when Jesus approached. And it's also easy to understand that after Jesus stepped into the Jordan River and was buried in baptism and raised out to do God's will, exactly how God wanted him to do it, that the Holy Spirit descended upon him and everything changed. Church, I want to tell you, when you step into the river's edge, everything changes. When you get into the point and place where you're ready to completely surrender to God, everything changes. When the Holy Spirit begins to guide you and direct you, everything changes. I want to talk about some of the reasons why Jesus had to be baptized by John. Purpose, if you're taking notes, purpose. John preached repentance, and all through the Bible, God calls the people to turn from their sins, to turn from their idols, to turn from their compromises and to turn to God to be saved. He's telling us the same thing today. Turn from your sins. Turn from your compromises. Turn from the things of this world, the things that you think are going to bring you pleasure that really have no value. We put so much stock in this earth, our earthly time here. And honestly, it's nothing compared to eternity. The most of us will ever see, if we're really lucky or really unlucky, depending how you look at it, we'd be 100 years old, right? I mean, we don't, nobody expects to live past 100, really. I mean, there's a few out there make 104, 105, 106, 107, you know. But come on, 100 years? How long is that compared to eternity? It's just a drip. Is it just a drip? And we put so much stock and so much value and so much importance on this temporary, fleeting life. My wife was sharing earlier, nobody's promised tomorrow. We don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. There's people that didn't wake up today. They thought they were going to lose an extra hour of sleep, and they're not waking up. We don't know when our time is coming, but you've got to understand that there is a purpose. And the purpose for baptism was the repentance of sin, yet John's baptism is just like the Christian baptism, buried with Christ in baptism, buried to our sins. Buried to the things that we think are so important, raised up to walk in his likeness, to live a new life on what's truly important. That's what John was preaching. That's what John was doing. And yet Jesus, even though he had no faults and no sins and no failures, he still came to John for baptism. We read it in the scripture already that it had to be done to fulfill what God had ordained. Now at this moment, you got to understand, we no longer, if we belong to him, we no longer are serving ourselves. We have a purpose. Jesus went to John to fulfill a purpose. Jesus was raised up out of the water, and the Holy Spirit descended upon him for a purpose. We are here today for a purpose. God called us to be part of his family for a purpose. Tell your neighbor, I got purpose. Jesus stepped into his heavenly Father's profession. Before this time, when Jesus walked up to that water edge, when he got on the edge of the Jordan River, he had been a small town carpenter in Bethlehem. His earthly father had been a carpenter, and I'm sure Jesus knew a lot about carpentry. He could probably make a table that would stand up for the test of time. Amen. But when he stepped into that river's edge, and he was baptized to fulfill the purpose that God had for him, and he was raised up out of that water, he wasn't a small town carpenter anymore. He was stepping forth to his Father's ministry. And church, I want to tell you something. Part of what we've got to understand is God's purpose for us is that we are no longer doing what we used to do, but now we are stepping forth into the heavenly calling that he has for us, that we can begin to fulfill the purpose for which we were created. We were not created to gratify and satisfy this. We were created for him. Scripture tells us, for him and by him, all things were created. Now, understand this. Many of us are called to different things. We're not all hands. We're not all feet. It would look really weird if we're all walking around just being hands, right? You know, I mean, luckily there's all different parts of the body, and we all work together to fulfill the purpose. My calling's not your calling, your calling's not my calling, so forth and so on. But each one of us has a purpose that God has ordained. John MacArthur explains that Jesus entering the baptismal waters was Christ identifying himself with sinners. Baptism was for the immoral, the impure, the liars, the adulterers, and the thieves. And yet Jesus willingly plunged into the water as to say, I'm with them. I don't think you understand. Jesus, who knew no sin, did what sinners did other than sin to identify with us so that we don't walk this life alone. He is with you. He's with me. Scripture tells us he'll never leave us nor forsake us. I'm with him. He's with me. Tell your neighbor, he's with me. Listen to Jesus' explanation in Matthew 3 and 15. Matthew 3 and 15, if we have it again there. I know I got y'all discombobulated, Jeff. It's not his fault, it's my fault. Y'all don't blame him. Okay. But Jesus said, it should be done, for we must carry out all that God requires. So John agreed to baptize him. This is Jesus' love for us, church. I want you to understand this. it caused him, his love for us caused him to step down into humanity, to be born as a baby. Y'all have heard me discuss this again and again and again. I just can't wrap my mind around it. How God, the most powerful, almighty being that ever existed, that spoke the world into existence and said, let there be light, and there was light, chose to come and be born as a helpless baby, dependent on human beings to care for them. If you don't understand this, maybe you've never had children. I have like a ton of them, okay? I could share one with you if you need it, okay? But I'm telling you, they can't do anything. I'm still getting up in the middle of the night multiple times a night because we have a baby. He can't get up and go make his own bottle. I don't know why yet. I'm trying to teach him to. Yeah. Come on, Dominion. You got to just go on over there, you know, put it in shake, three scoops, one, you know. No. That's what God did for us. He left the power of heaven, the ability to speak, to come and be born as a baby. Helpless and dependent. He stepped down into the baptismal waters with John, even though he had done no sin, even though he had known no wrong. He died on Calvary's cross, even though he had committed no sin, even though he had done no wrong, so that our sins can be forgiven. He stepped down into humanity so that he could identify with us. And he stepped in that river because of his love for us. And he calls us to him because he loves us. Somebody asked me the other day, how come we got a choice? How come God just don't make us do what's right? I mean, that'd be easy, right? If God just make us do what's right, you know what I mean? We have a choice. I told him, I said, it wouldn't mean the same. You see, when your children choose to love you, when your children choose to take time for you, when your children choose to listen to you and obey what you've tried to instruct them because you know what's best, it blesses your heart. And that's what God wants from us, our willing obedience. He willingly sacrificed. He's looking for us to willingly obey. He came. He became like me. So I could be like him. Tell your neighbor, he became like me so I could be like him. I know it was more than three words, right? It was hard, right? Yeah. He became like me so I could become like him. I want you to remember that. You write it down if you got to. That Jesus became like you so you can become like him. Jesus' ministry began in the river and ended on the cross. And even though his followers would not realize it for some time, Jesus' baptism on that day in the river was in fact a foreshadowing of his death on the cross. Buried with Christ in baptism. That's how we do it nowadays. Raised in his likeness to walk in newness of life. At that moment when Jesus stepped into that river to fulfill God's purpose, he was saying, I'm dying to every other thing that I've been here on this earth to do. And when I come up out of this water, I will only serve God's purpose for my life. In other words, he said, it's on, right? Tell your neighbor, it's on. Second point, representation. Jesus stepped into the baptismal waters. He stepped into the Jordan River for representation. To the Jews, baptism was a method of ritual purification. John baptized for repentance and forgiveness of sins. Jesus would add a whole new level to the meaning as baptism was the repentance representation of death, burial, and his resurrection. So again, the representation, the picture that he set forth was he's stepping into the river. He was dying right there. And then his burial, being submerged under the water. And then his resurrection, behold, rising again. It's a representation of what's yet to come. Romans chapter 6, verse 3. Romans chapter 6, verse 3. Or have you forgotten that when we were joined with Christ Jesus in baptism, we joined him in death? For we did and were buried with Christ by baptism. And just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glorious power of the Father, now we also may live new lives. And so the scripture is saying we died and were buried with Christ. At church, you got to understand, when we step forward to say, I'm no longer living for myself, we're realizing we've been bought and paid for. Here's the interesting thing. I'll give you a scenario. If I go out and I buy a truck, like a Toyota Tundra, that's an inside joke, okay? I had one. I traded it for a little tiny midget car because Alexandria couldn't drive it. But if I go out and buy a Toyota truck, Tundra, and I pay cash for it, who owns that truck? Me. And if anybody else gets in that truck and takes off with it without my permission, what is it called? It's called Grand Theft Auto. You stole it, right? When you get caught, you go into jail, right? That's what it's called, right? I mean, and why is it? Because it belongs to the person that purchased it. If you buy a truck and somebody else takes it without your permission, it's called stealing, right? We've been bought and paid for with a price. And every time we take ownership or we think that we take our ownership back and we do what we want to do with our life instead of what God wants to do with our life, what is it called? Stealing. I thought somebody was going to say Grand Theft Auto, but you know. No, it's called stealing. We're taking something that doesn't belong to us because it's been purchased, it's been bought. You may have used to own it, but if you go and sell a car tomorrow and you sign the title and give it to somebody, you can't take the spare set of keys you forgot to give them and go back and pick it back up. It's called stealing. But we do that, don't we? We come to the altar, we give our lives to Christ, we say, Lord, no longer will I live for myself, I'm going to live for you, I'm dying to everything. Everything else doesn't matter, you are it, Lord God, I trust you, I love you, I'm serving you. And we leave all excited about it, and next week, we're back there doing the same old things that we used to do, and saying, well, it's my right, I got a right. No, you don't. You gave your life to Christ. It's been bought and paid for. Just as the representation that Jesus gave us in baptism, so is the representation when we die to ourselves to live for him. Baptism is the washing of our hearts from sin, dying to our old way of life and being raised to walk in Jesus' likeness. Behold, the old man is dead and we become a new creature. Tell your neighbor, the old is gone. Power. Rising up out of the river. If you're taking notes, the third point is power. Lucky for you today, it's only a three-point message. Amen. My wife's working on a six-point one. I was like, can I borrow that and make a series out of it? That's what I said, 6 points. Well, I never get through that. Amen. Power. Power is the third. Rising up out of the river, Jesus was soaked. And at that moment, the Bible says in Matthew 3, verses 16 and 17, Matthew 3, verses 16 and 17. After his baptism, as Jesus came up out of the water, the heavens were opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and settling on him. And a voice from heaven said, this is my dearly loved Son who brings me great joy. What a sight. The Spirit of God descending on Jesus in front of everybody. There's power when the Spirit comes upon you. I think back to Peter as I think about the power of the Holy Spirit. Peter was so dedicated to serving Jesus, and he was a great disciple. And if you remember anything about the story of Peter, you know, on the day in the upper room as they took the Last Supper, you know, Jesus said that all these things were going to take place, and you know, he was going to die, and everybody was going to abandon him. And Peter's like, "Not I! I'll never abandon you, Lord God. It's not going to happen. No, not me. Everybody else maybe, but not me." And if you remember the story, Jesus said, Peter, before the rooster crows, you'll deny me 3 times. And Peter left that room absolutely certain that Jesus didn't know what he was talking about. Y'all ever felt that way? Like the Lord tells you something like, nah, I'm dedicated, Lord. I ain't going backwards. I ain't giving up. I ain't going to compromise. I'm going to do what I'm supposed to do. And all along the Lord's telling you, hey, watch out now. Pay attention now. And we're like, no, not me. We always think we're stronger than we actually are, aren't we? Yeah. And Peter, Peter was that way. And you know what happened? Those of you who know the story already know. Guess what? Jesus was right, because God ain't never wrong, right? So Jesus was right. Peter denied him, even to the point of cursing, the Bible tells us. No, it wasn't me. I wasn't with him. Denied him three times. And then the rooster crowed, and then he heard the rooster, and he remembered God's words, and he was heartbroken. And shortly thereafter, Peter, as he's in the upper room and they're praying, and after Jesus has already revealed himself as resurrected and he's already ascended to heaven, they're in the upper room praying, and the Holy Spirit descends like a dove, and they're all touched with cloven tongues of fire. Peter gets up in front of the very same people that he denied Christ to, gets up in front of the very same religious rulers and leaders that had crucified Jesus and had ordered it, and begins to speak and testify and proclaim of who Jesus Christ is. The one who couldn't even publicly honor him, now that the Holy Spirit has landed upon him and touched him and filled him, he is bold. And he's preaching, and he's declaring, and he's testifying, and he's doing that which he could not do on his own. He's doing by the power of the Holy Spirit. And church, I want to tell you, when you give your life to Christ and you welcome the Holy Spirit into your heart and you ask God to take over, there is power that is available to you. There's power that's available to you to do that which you could not do on your own. For some of us, maybe that's giving up an addiction. For some of us, maybe it's living a right life. For some of us, maybe it's reading the Bible and understanding it. So many times I hear people say, I read it, but I don't understand it. When the author of the Bible begins to live in you, it will begin to make sense. And if it don't make sense, ask him to reveal it to you. Who better to ask than the author, right? If you're reading a book and you don't understand what the author meant, you see the author, you can ask him, hey, what'd you mean by this? Who can tell you better than the person who wrote it, right? Jesus, in your life in Christ is powerful. And that was a representation, and that was what God wanted us to see, that there is power when we step forth to what God has called us to do. Believe it or not, every believer receives that power. That power that raised Christ from the dead, that power that landed on Jesus as he came up out of the Jordan River, that power that enabled Peter to proclaim and speak in front of the very same people that he had once denied Christ to, that same power is available to every believer. Mark 1 and 8 tells us, I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. Church, in God, there are no less thans. Tell your neighbor, God loves me. I want to say that again. In God, there are no less thans. Because the enemy always wants us to think that we're less than somebody else, or somebody's better than us, or somebody can do it better or do it greater. And the reality is, if you'll just step out the way and let God have his way in your life, there will be no less thans. Amen? Amen. The promise is for you and I, Romans 8 and 11. Romans 8 and 11 says, the Spirit of God who raised Jesus from the dead lives in you. What Spirit is that? The same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead, the Holy Spirit, lives in you. Scripture tells us, the Spirit of God who raised Jesus from the dead lives in you. And just as God raised Christ Jesus from the dead, he will give life to your mortal bodies by the same Spirit living within you. Church, there is power right here if you belong to him. There's power to overcome, power to be obedient, power to do exactly what God has called you to do. Ephesians 1 and 18. I pray that your hearts will be flooded with light so that you can understand the confident hope he has given to those he called and his holy people who are his rich and glorious inheritance. He's talking to us, the people who would choose to accept him. We are part of that rich and glorious inheritance. He says, I also pray that you will understand the incredible greatness of God's power for us who believe. For who? Tell your neighbor, for believers. If that's you, tell your neighbor, me. Oh, me. It's me. Amen. the incredible greatness of God's power who is for me. This is the same mighty power that raised Christ from the dead and seated him in the place of honor at God's right hand in the heavenly realms. Next time anyone tells you that you can't, you tell them, oh, yes, I can. Next time the enemy tells you that you can't, next time your mind tells you that you can't, you respond, oh, yes, I can do everything that God has called me to do, because the same mighty power that was there when Christ was baptized, the same mighty power that was there when Peter preached that sermon, the same mighty power that was there when God raised Christ Jesus from the dead and seated him in the heavenly realms far above all other powers and principalities and placed all things underneath his feet, is the same mighty power that lives right here. How can you not do what God has called you to do? How can you not overcome? How if God be for you, who can be against you? Nobody. Now he's far above any ruler and all authority and power or leader or anything else, not only in this world, but also in the world to come. Do I have verse 22? If I do, show it to me. Oh. God has put all things under the authority of Christ and has made him head over all things for the benefit of the church. Well, we got through all the scriptures. That's good. The same mighty power that raised Christ from the dead is the same power that's available to you and I. We just got to follow Jesus, church. If we will follow Jesus in obedience, if we will follow Jesus where he leads us, where he guides us, where he takes us, we will overcome. As the praise team gets ready to come up here and we get ready to close, I know many of us have struggled with fear, with regret, with disbelief. We hear messages like this. We hear the preacher saying it, and we read it, and we know it's true. But somewhere, somehow, right here, we just can't feel it. We don't understand, God, you know, why am I going through what I'm going through? If that power is there for me, how come I can't feel it? Today, I want you to understand that you can choose to trust Jesus. Quick illustration for you as they're getting ready to lead us. You know, when you first meet somebody and you fall in love, there's this little pitter-patter of your heart, right? Y'all know what I'm talking about. Anybody ever been in love? Say amen. Amen. Your heart beats a little faster. You know, you get next to him and you know, you're like, oh, you just can't wait to be with him. You can't wait to talk to him. You know, the absence makes the heart grow fonder, right? You know what I mean? All those things are so true. And you got all these things that pitter-patter your heart about love. And then you get, I know, right? And then you get married and life happens and the pitter-patters, they're not there no more in love. It's there sometimes. Like Donna Stephanie is always there, right? But, okay, maybe the pitter-patter's not there anymore. But love, it's called kids, right? Yeah. Love is still there. And love is a choice at that point in time, right? It's a commitment. You choose. You choose to love even when you don't feel loving yourself. Even when you don't feel loved, you choose to love anyways. And I'm telling you, the same is true today. If you will choose to follow Jesus, if you will choose to forget about the emotions behind it and the pitter-patter of your heart or the excitement of this and that, and you choose to get up and say, God, I believe your word because it says so. I choose to believe what you say. I know you don't lie. So even though I don't feel it, even though I can't see it, I'm going to testify, right? I'm going to testify and I'm going to live my life just the way you called me to. If that's you today, when this altar opens, I want you to come. I want you to allow our altar team to pray with you. And I want you to receive what God wants you to receive. Step into the Jordan. Follow him to the river. Die to yourself and live for him. Will you stand with me? Father, we thank you. We thank you so much that regardless of how we feel, Your word is true. And there's power available to us who believe. Power to overcome. Power to stay the course. Power to not look back. Today, Lord, I'm asking if there's anyone here that's been far from you, today they'll draw close to you. If there's anybody here, Lord, that hasn't made a decision to be your child and they're missing that ownership that you have, today, Lord, they'll surrender and they'll become yours. We thank you for this. In Jesus' name, the altar's open. Will you go?
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was born. No reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Come to
the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was born.
Church. Church, sing it out to him.
Let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven. Let it rain. Let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven. Let it rain.
We feel the rain of your love. We feel the wind of your spirit. Now the heartbeat of heaven, let us hear. Oh, we feel the rain of your love. We feel the wind of your spirit. Now the heartbeat of heaven, let us hear. We feel the rain of your love. We feel the wind of your spirit. And now the heartbeat of heaven, let us hear. We feel the rain of your love. We feel the wind of your spirit. And now the heartbeat of heaven, let us hear.
Tell your neighbor, I'm following Jesus.
I'm following Jesus.
Amen. So the praise team is going to stay up front. The prayer team will be here if you need prayer. I'm going to ask Richie to close us in prayer.
Father Heaven, we thank you for this day. We thank you for all those that are seeking you, Lord. We thank you for the mercy and the love and the grace that you show us each and every day, Lord. We praise you. We worship you. We need you. In your Son's precious name, we pray. Amen.